Our next speakers are Krister Fröjdh, Vice President R&D at Proximion, and Daniel Wiklund, Unit Manager Component Manufacturing at Rice. The title of their presentation is New Press Deflection Measuring Method Based Using Optical Fiber Bragg Grating Technology and Substitutive Press Models for Efficient Die Cambering. I give the floor to Dr. Krister Fröjdh and Dr. Daniel Wiklund.
Thank you very much, Ingela. I will soon hand over the word to Krister, but as an introduction, I just would like to mention that this research was carried out within Smart Eureka. And the partners in this project, it has been Matrisi, Fagor Arasate, Mondragon University, Volvo Car Corporation, Rice, Blekinge University, and Proximion. So, optical fiber Bragg grating technology. And I hand over the word to you, Krister.
Yeah, hello everybody. This is just a very brief introduction to our company. So this is a company is Proximion. It's a part of the Hexatronic Group, and we are manufacturing fiber bragg grating and making systems. So this is a part with where we have close cooperation with Rice to develop this sensor system. So, and we have our facilities and production in Kista, and and we do a lot of different. I would say we are world biggest manufacturer of fiber bragg gratings. So, please next slide. So, what is the fiber bragg grating? Yeah, you take an optical fiber, many of you have optical fiber to your home today, and it's like a hair. Thin as a hair, and inside that you have a core, and it turns out that this core is sensitive to ultraviolet light. So by creating an interference pattern onto the fiber, you can create these fringes inside the fiber that will give you very weak reflection. And by changing the period of the fringes, you can also change the wavelength of the reflected light. And you can do this in a different way. Most manufacturers, they use a face mask. That is something you create and buy in advance. But we use a patent methodology where we have a software, total software control and can do customized grating, which we have done in this case. Please, next slide. So here we have an optical fiber. And in the fiber, we have imprinted a number of fiber bragg gratings with slightly different wavelengths. So if you have just one fiber grating and you send in a broad spectral light, as you see at the top left, then for the light wavelength that meet the bragg grating, then just that wavelength will be reflected and the rest of the spectrum will be transmitted through the fiber. And this makes it possible to combine multiple gratings with slightly different wavelength in the fiber to then to have sensors at different points. And the wavelength of this reflected light is dependent on the temperature and also on the strain of the fiber. So we can use the fiber as a temperature sensor and as a strain sensor. In this project, we have used it as a strain sensor. Next slide, please. When we start at the as a temperature sensor, there is a quite small temperature dependence of the grating. It's about one part in 100,000 for each degree of Celsius. So what happens is when you apply heat on the fiber, the sensors, the wavelength reflected by the sensors are shifted. And the shift is quite small, but if you can make very accurate equipment to measure wavelength, and that's also a product that we manufacture. And from this, you can create a temperature profile along the fiber. That is in many cases very interesting for different process monitoring. So I think this one more. You can see below, you see the temperature profile. And if we take the next slide here, we can also set that as a strain sensor, because when you stretch the fiber, you will change the period of the fiber Bragg grating, and that will also affect the way length. So in this way, you can create you can measure the strain profile along the fiber. And the fiber in this case need to be glued or in some way fixed to the substrate that where you want to measure the strain. And this is also quite a small change, so you need special measurement equipment. This is called an interrogator that measures this small shift in wave length. And then we can take the next slide. And here you see a typical system. This is for a temperature measurement, but it will be very similar to for a strain system. The only difference will be how you mount the sensors. And then you have like an interrogator system here in orange, which does make this very accurate wavelength measurement. And of course, you need to have some user interface to display the profiles to the users. In this case, we are showing a two-dimensional temperature map used in steel casting. So after this very brief introduction, I hope you got some clue about it anyway. I leave the word to Daniel to continue with the actual implementation.
Thank you very much, Krister. And I'm going to talk about new press deflection measuring method. So this is a beam, we call it a sensor beam. And we milled tracks in this beam, and then we glued fibers, optics in these tracks. And then this beam could be used to measure deflections. We verified this technology in this test bench, where we apply different load and verified with dial indicators. But you need also to consider the clamping strategy. So we tested different clamping strategies. We used tape and we used magnets, as you can see in the image here. And in this case, we had also oil in between the table and the sensor beam. And the result was these results. And we had poor correlation of the sensor beam and the reference system, because we had some stick slips phenomena. So the optimum strategy for fixating was to fixate it, to have a fixed connection between the sensor beam and the table. And then we had a good correlation. But in that case, you need to consider the distance from the fiber to the neutral layer of the table when you calculate the deflections. Then we took these sensor beams and applied them on a table. And you can see we have a sensor beam on top of the table, and then we have a polyurethane material which used to distribute the load, and then a hollow beam, and then a clamping force. These white markers were used for the reference system, camera system. And these are some of the results. You have a top view and different sensor beam, 7 beams, as you can see. And these are the results. You have force on this axis and a linear correlation to load, linear correlation to deflections, as expected. And the geometry of the table, you are shown to the left, and we have a double curved geometry. And the maximum in this case was about 0.5 4 millimeters. We validated these results with this Aramis 3D camera system, and we had a good correlation between this system and our sensor beam. So there was a significant level at 99.9%. Before I talk about the possibilities with this type of technology and the benefits, I would like to introduce you to substitutive press models, because the real strength is shown when you use these technologies together. So this is a configuration of a substitutive press model made of shell elements. So you have the slide, and this slide is then deformable, and also the table is deformable. And then we have a plane which can be used to apply a force on the blank holder, and then a tool set. This one could also be tilted, but I will not go into details right now. In this image, the crosses represent measurements from a real press. And then we used an optimization algorithm in order to imitate the press dynamics. So we can optimize this press frame. We can have different thickness. And then we can imitate the dynamics of, for example, the press table. This is an exploded view of a bolster with various thickness of the supporting framework. And now I would like to show you a very interesting case. So this is a substitutive press model, and it's from a tool maker. And in reality, there were several tool stations in this, but they are not shown. But the toolmaker manufactured the tool. But then there was a real problem, because the press at the toolmaker is much weaker than the press at the OEM. And before delivery, there are certain requirements that needs to be fulfilled. For example, the contact conditions, in other words, the spotting image. And since the press was weaker, okay, first, just forming. So, since the press was weaker, it was difficult to obtain a good spotting image. So you can see it, as you can see, this is a real spotting image. But if this technology had been available, then you could use the substitutive model, and the press dynamics of the OEM could have been considered, and then the surface would have been compensated in respect to the OEM press. And then maybe just perform some fine tuning at the end. You can see also in this image, this is a numerical simulation where we have the press dynamic included, and you can see we have quite good representation of the dynamics. It imitates this quite well. And then you can also perform numerical compensation of a tooling surface and to account for press deflections. So we have compensated the surface and performed again a spot image of the compensation, and you can see it is the contact has improved. So, smart industry in practice. The idea with this technology is to design presses with embedded fibers in the press table and in the slide. And also it could be tools and other places. And this could be used for anomaly detection. So in a state of art industry, you could we have it linked to a cloud database cloud, and then monitoring tool health, press health, and occasional events like double sheet, and also the influence of hydraulic press drops. And as I showed you, it could also be used for die virtual spotting and cambering. So you have your digital twin, you camber the tool, compensate the tool, you have a CAD model manufacturing, and then you perform tryouts. And if you then have embedded fiber optics in your press, then you obtain a strain history response. And this could be compared to the strain history response in your digital twin. And if it's, then you can see if it's okay or not. And if it's not okay, you can feed the strain response from the physical tool or press back to the digital twin and then recreate the conditions in the tool. So you have the deviations from the CAD model and perform adjustments. This loop is ready, and as I showed, this is something we have not done, so, but we think it's possible also to design this loop if we just have the opportunity. And finally, tools could also be cambered and adapted to more than one press line. This means that manufacturing operations could manage fluctuating load between production units.
As you can see, we've had some technical issues, but we will give you the opportunity to ask questions to Krister and Daniel in the Q&A sessions later on. And we will now move on in our program.